Hello there, I'm Nemo, and prepare your molecular scissors because today we are gonna cut some genes. No, not those genes. These genes. Perfect. Nice. Hey Travis, how are you doing today?
Good man, how's it going?
I'm doing pretty good, thank you. It's super cool to have you here. So, what do you think? Should we talk about gene editing?
Sure.
Cool, you start.
No, you start.
Nah, you start.
Okay, I'll start. Each cell in your body contains the integrity of your genome, your genetic blueprint. And it consists of DNA, a very long molecule containing 3 million base pairs and 25,000 genes. Those genes carry the necessary information for your growth, development, functioning, and reproduction. They make you who you are. They shape you as an individual, but they also shape us as a species. And recent technological innovations have allowed scientists to sequence our entire genome, to see which genetic mutations cause which genetic diseases.
To fully grasp the function of genes, we need to manipulate them. We need a tool that allows us to edit DNA with extreme precision and very high specificity, like scissors, but at the molecular level. Does that tool exist yet? Or is it more like sci-fi material?
It exists, and it's called CRISPR-Cas9.
Let's go a few years back. 1987. Ronald Reagan is the president of the United States. That year, The Simpsons first appear on TV. We also have the first criminal convicted by DNA evidence, and if you look up, you can see with your naked eye the supernova SN1987A exploding in the sky. But what is special to me about 1987, especially in the context of this episode, is that during that year, Dr. Ishino and his team discovered very weird sequences in the genome of Escherichia coli. Those genetic sequences were repeated in nature, but also palindromic. They couldn't find any similarities with other sequences in their database, and the function of those sequences just remained a mystery for a very long time. Over the next decade, other scientists found more of those intriguing repeats in other single-cell organisms. This couldn't be a coincidence. If those repeats were conserved across different species, they must have had a purpose. Dr. Morica and Dr. Janssen were the first one to call those sequences with the name we still call them today. CRISPR, for clustered, regularly interspaced, short, palindromic repeats. Hey Travis, try to say that 5 times.
Clustered, regularly interspaced, short, palindromic repeats. 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 Clustered, regularly interspaced, short, palindromic repeats.
Good one. And it's only in the early 2000s that Dr. Morica noticed that those sequences found in bacteria were very similar to DNA sequences found in viruses. But why would bacteria have integrated in their genome viral sequences? This doesn't make sense. In 2007, while trying to find ways to improve the bacterial culture in dairy products, Philip Horvath noticed that viruses called bacteriophage could not infect bacteria which had those CRISPR sequences integrated in their genome, suggesting that those CRISPR repeats had something to do with their immune system against viruses, a defense mechanism. Go away! And that was indeed true. It was discovered that Cas protein for CRISPR associated would use copies of those CRISPR sequences called guide RNA to guide them, find matching viral DNA, cut it apart, disabling it.
What happens if you take a Cas protein that cuts DNA and you give it a synthetic gRNA, targeting any DNA sequence that you want?
Well, that is a brilliant idea, and it is essentially what scientists have done between 2012 and 2013. They hijacked a Cas protein called Cas9 to virtually cut the DNA of any organism. Literally molecular scissors. How is that tool useful? Let's go a few steps back. Your DNA is like an extremely complicated blueprint, telling a unique story, but also a universal one. It's a story about you and who you are as a biological being. You can also see it as a very long genetic book. And when I say long, I mean like very long. Your entire genome fits in 200 books. And it's made of chapters, sentences, words and letters, all interconnected together, carrying a huge message. Also, like in real life, you might find some typo here and there, mutations. Most of the time, those mutations are silent, so they don't have any impact. But sometimes, even single base mutation can lead to the malfunction of a gene at the origin of genetic diseases. That's the case for sickle cell anemia, for example. One single base mutation is all it takes to turn a normal hemoglobin protein into a defective one, resulting in physiological malfunction. Keeping the book analogy, imagine a typo that not only changed the meaning of a sentence, but the meaning of the entire book. Imagine you have a magical cursor with an integrated Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V function. What can you do with it? Well, you can delete the sentence or you can change it. In other genetic words, you could disable the gene or modify it. When Cas9 cuts the double-strand DNA, the cell machinery tries to repair the two pieces. Unfortunately, this repair mechanism is not perfect, and very often it introduces mistakes, errors, mutations. And when those mutations are in the middle of a gene, they can potentially deactivate it, like a glitch in the middle of a sentence. This is what we call a knockout or KO, and this is very useful because it can be used to study the function of a gene by disabling it. But you can also use the cut you made with Cas9 to modify a few bases or insert a new gene, the equivalent of a cut and paste move, but at the molecular level. This is what we called a knock-in or KI. And if you're inserting a new gene that was not there before, you're literally creating a transgenic animal. Of course, being able to edit genomes is an amazing power. But what makes CRISPR-Cas9 a revolution in terms of gene editing is how efficient and specific it is.
We have the power to use CRISPR-Cas9 to switch off a gene to study its function. We can make neurons glow whenever they fire in order to learn more about the brain. Fix human genetic diseases, not just by treating the symptoms, but by correcting the origin of the disease. But can we do more? And if yes, should we?
Where do we draw the line between therapy and enhancement? How is CRISPR going to change the nature of what makes us human? Those are all important questions to ask, and if you guys are interested in the ethics and philosophy behind the use of CRISPR, you should check out the new video of Travis on his channel Curious Tangents. CRISPR is a revolutionary tool that had an immense impact on research, and that will definitely change the medicine of tomorrow. And yeah, of course, some people will say it's a very dangerous tool. I do believe it's a very powerful tool, but like scissors, it's not inherently good or bad. What makes it good or bad is how you use it. That's why we have to be very wise, because with great powers come great responsibilities. What I find fascinating about CRISPR is how its discovery epitomizes how fundamental research works. In fact, in 1987, Dr. Ishino and his team, they were not trying to find a new gene editing tool that would revolutionize modern medicine. Instead, they were just trying to understand how bacteria can survive in salty water. And why would someone want to do that in the first place? Well, curiosity. curiosity is a very big driving force in science. Research can be split into applied and basic or fundamental research. Applied research is designed to answer specific questions aimed at solving practical problems. On the other hand, the aim of basic research is to gain knowledge and insights about fundamental mechanisms. Basic research doesn't aim at direct application, but provides the scientific basis on which further research and application can be based on.
Although the transferability of basic research and its real-world applications cannot be predicted, and the direct short-term benefits cannot be planned, scientific and medical breakthroughs are not conceivable without the knowledge that basic research provides, and therefore it's fundamentally important and indispensable. The people who discovered CRISPR were not on a quest to discover how to edit the human genome. They weren't even looking for a way to edit genetic diseases. They were just trying to find an answer to some fundamental questions. They were curious. And without curiosity, we may not have CRISPR, a tool that can be used to edit genetic diseases and shape in the best way possible our tomorrow.
The important lesson here is always be curious.
Because curiosity can change the world.
If you could use CRISPR to modify your DNA or the DNA of an organism, what would you do? Leave a comment below. I'm very curious to read your crazy ideas. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, please consider subscribing to the channel. You can support me and my work by becoming one of my patrons on Patreon or buying my merch. Also, I have a second channel on which I just put random stuff. I have a Discord server and I'm on Instagram and Twitter. Again, I hope you enjoyed the video and I'll see you very soon for another episode of, well, I don't know. Thank you.